So this is what left the Arabs of the time, by the way, until today, unable to respond. Until today, unable to respond. The Quran actually puts forward a challenge that if this book was from other than God, God challenges human beings to bring or to make something that is comparable to it. Now, this challenge is often misunderstood by people, and they think it's just, you know, like, well, okay, so the Quran is beautiful, right? So the Arabs thought it was nice, and it sounded beautiful. But, you know, Shakespeare is nice as well, and we have lots of poets. They make nice poems. So that doesn't mean it's from God, which is a fair enough point, but that's not what the Quran is saying. And whoever says that doesn't understand the context of this challenge. And the context of this challenge is that Arabic in the time of the Prophet Muhammad, the Arabic language in the time of the Prophet Muhammad in that location, was something that was clearly defined in respect to its compartments of speech. So there were different types of speech. There was poetry, there was rhymed prose, there was rhetoric, there was normal speech. There was another type of speech called Sijin, which was a type of, it's how soothsayers, they used to talk in a special type of speech. And whenever someone spoke in Arabic, you could define which one of these categories that person was speaking in. Poetry itself was divided into 16 or 17 bihar. So there's 16 forms of poetry in Arabic as well. So what's interesting about the Quran is that it didn't conform to any of those patterns. It was itself a unique pattern. It was a unique format, so as to speak. And this is a very specific challenge of the Quran. Not just to produce something eloquent and beautiful, but to bring a format of speech, of Arabic speech, that is of comparable beauty and impact. So this is what left the Arabs of the time, by the way, until today, unable to respond. Until today, unable to respond. The Quran still retains that position of being a unique form of the language. No one has been able to produce something of its eloquence and its unique format. So this is the challenge of the Quran. It was particularly poignant because the Arabs at the time of the Prophet Muhammad were truly masters of their language. They were masters of their language. I want to give you an example. And this always sticks in my mind because this was told to me by an Arab friend of mine. He was actually reading a book of poems. And this book of poems was written by a man, a poet, who had an issue with another tribe. And his way of dealing with this issue was writing poetry against them. And my friend was reading this book, I remember it until this day, and he was reading the book, walking around, and he says, oh my God, he killed them. Oh my God, he destroyed them. Oh, he finished them. So after a bit, I said, Jamal, listen, bro, who killed, who destroyed, who did, you know, what's going on here? And he said, this is a poem. This man, well, I don't remember the poet's name. He wrote this poem against the tribe. He said, do you know, Abdurraheem, until this day, the tribe calls itself by a different name because they don't want people to say, oh, you're from the tribe of that poet. This is the power of their language. This was the power of their language. Yet the Quran came and their best poets, their best literary geniuses were unable. They were literally speechless. In fact, one of the greatest poets, names slip my mind right now, recognized as being one of the greatest poets and he of the Arabic language, and he was alive during the time of the Prophet. He actually gave up poetry. He said, I can't. After the Quran, I can't. I can't recite poetry anymore. They would ask him, recite some poetry. He said, what, after the Quran? There's nothing to recite. So it had a very profound impact. And it's something you can study. Historically, you can see that. And you can study it. Until today, you can study the Arabic language.